they've probably a big range of been trying to stuff it really, didn't they? Yes. Treat you boys as the same,
eh?
Well, you had to watch them. They thought they could eat us the way and get out of it.
That's right, that's right.
And they were pushing it down and we didn't watch it. Somebody the same. You guys can see when I was in my meetings, I used to lie down and fall asleep on the sofa.
Ah.
Forgot what they were at. We went up to see what was the weighing like. Maybe I'm lying asleep on the floor. Remember Akamura? Never seen them.
Oh, that's what you
got in
me.
Still never have.
No, it was a village, the village hall that I got run into at, and like there's, it's only every month, you know.
The middle of the week, a Wednesday. Getting home at 6:15 was only possible if I pulled out all the stops and averaged 70 miles per hour between Belfast and Larne. Hitting 95 in the motorway and weaving in and out of the traffic on the single carriageway between Corrs and Jingles Corner. It wasn't conducive to reason, that helter-skelter shadowed by thoughts of blowouts, accidents that I've seen on the road, and the tearing contemplation of the mechanics of injury. The drive afforded thinking time that I could only use to figure out the drive itself. It was too important to be aware of the car for my attention to the road to be mulling over unrelated topics. Still burning, breathless in my head from the speed, I wasn't thinking right. Sheila was cooking, and Paddy was sitting at the kitchen table threatening the kids in his way. This young policeman had me down as a drinking buddy, ready for anything, and I rarely disappointed him. Are you going to see Rambo then? Asking for confirmation of the scheme rather than proposing it as a possibility. Rambo was playing at the ABC in Belfast. I had been making vague promises that he and I would go out some night, and, like I said, I was in a mindfuck from the journey in hyperspeed. Okay, I replied. Doors open at 6:45. I shoveled chips and fish fingers as quickly as I could. I'll drive, you pay. No problem. Paddy was 22. Building a house with bank loans and hadn't a notion how to hang on to his money. His checkbook was so easy to use he would blow £100 a night and not know it. I'd heard talk about his wife of 1 year being kind of distraught lately about the way he was behaving. Blowing money, refusing to be accountable to anyone, letting people down at the building site. Not picking up on the bills and letting his brother carry the costs of his half of the construction as well. But I didn't get involved in all this. I tolerated Sheila's family because they were Sheila's family and they came to call. Her brother and I were going to see Rambo. We made Belfast in 20 minutes, pushing the escort even faster than I had done on the way down. At the ABC, the doorman was setting a house full sign at the door, and a queue of about 40 people were deciding either to split or to try out the Jungle Book or Brewster's Minions. We stood panting on Great Victoria Street, wondering what the hell to do. Across the road, the Crown Bar looked an inviting place to think. I got a flat pills, Paddy a cool Smithwick, and we checked out the bar and discussed how little we knew about Belfast nightlife. We ate crisps. We didn't have another beer. Decided to call on Harry to see if he could point us towards some entertainment. Harry is a sensitive guy, living with his mother. Rambo was not his idea of a good time, and it was dumb to assume he might know an equivalent. Even dumber to ask on a Wednesday night. Harry was clearing the dishes away after the curry he'd made for his old mum and his friend Paul. Paddy sat in the corner making very childish interjections as I explained the situation. Harry took off to the kitchen with Paul as if they were a married couple and Malcolm McDowell had come to visit. Reappearing after an interminable period of small talk about coronary thrombosis with his mother. I excused us, finishing off the can of beer we'd been issued with at the point of entry. At the front door, Harry mentioned the notorious Heart Bar, a place of ill repute, the only place in Belfast with a strip show. I had never been there and wasn't keen, but it sounded good to Paddy. I got some directions, and off we went.
You
I can't be sure if it was indeed the harp bar behind that metal-sheeted door on that shabby back street not far from the city centre. As we approached, a middle-aged man with a cap and pipe came in. "It's closed," he said. "But you can try if you like." We knocked, then rang the bell. There were posters for punk concerts on the door, decaying wall. A man opened the door a fraction, looked at us, let us in. A long, skinny bar that had seen better days. One old lad parked on a stool, an alcove at the back making an L shape of the place. Paddy ordered vodka and coke twice. The tables in the alcove had formica tops and steamed beer mats. A TV overlooked us, as did antique framed boxing posters. Photographs of one-time celebrities visiting the bar. Fading sporting pages behind grimy glass. A pit. Nice place, Paddy. Ah, this is the place to be, all right. Are you not supposed to be at the house tonight? Oh, aye, but this is the place to be. Well, what's your dad going to say when you don't turn up at the house? I saw him before I came down to your house. And? Well, we're supposed to be putting in the septic tank tonight. You told me to go and get a bag of cement. Did you? Nah. I came down to your house. You mean he'll have gone over to the house to wait for you? Sure, this is the place to be. Where's this strip? Thank God there was no stripper. With the second vodka, the place started looking good, and I started having a sort of brotherly concern for Paddy, beginning with a few words about responsibility to yourself, but not to the rest of the world. This went pretty well till I went to the toilet. I stepped through the sliding door and got such a shock that I was the property of the booze for the rest of the night. In a movie once, I saw a guy open a door into some other world full of stars and strange creatures, not unlike having a gateway in the fridge, Ghostbusters style. This toilet, the first thing I saw was night sky. It was open-roofed, stinking, decrepit, and cold. Everything slid in my head. I took a piss. A heavy breathing piss, the way you do when you've been drinking and you've only just realised how much. Sitting with Paddy was unreal, and that was the way things were going. I couldn't stay in the toilet, it was raining on me. The alternative was a commitment to whatever was coming next. Back at the table, another drink set up for me. I hadn't a hope in hell of re-establishing control. I fell in head first. Paddy began to regale my dizzy head with stories of his work. He and his workmates would take their patrol car to a country road, break out their carry-out and start the night shift by getting juiced. Later calls to public houses after hours would furnish wine and spirits aplenty. Then the general public were fair game. Tales of urinating in the middle of the road while cautioning late-nighters in cars. Tales of abuse of position. Tales of hilarity at the expense of prisoners and cells, of rough stuff where the recipients, gougers, may as well have been rag dolls. Tales of unease. Time to go, Paddy. Oh, this is a place to be. It's a hell of a drive to Larne. Well, let's go and get a carry out. Right, come on. You're driving. We'll go to Coldwater House. Okay. That's the place to be. A big silver moon hung above the Albert clock with its illuminated face. One told me it was 9:45 p.m. The other spoke of madness and coaxed me further into caring less and less about what was happening. I drive fast of necessity and boredom. Paddy drove fast to impress me. I couldn't care less, sodden in the comfort of my anorak in the cold car. Navigating was easy. All roads were heading our direction. Through the one-way system of Belfast, onto the shore road towards Carrickfergus, everything slick and wet under streetlights. Talking of what Paddy was going to buy at the off-license, if we ever reached it. Paddy wanted beer, strong beer. Chuckling soup, he called it. I have to say that if I drank beer after starting vodka, I wouldn't last very long. Paddy was buying again. The first off license was closed. The second was Mulvenna's, and it was closing, but a quick leap out of the car brought Paddy to the door in time to cajole the doorman into letting him in. 5 minutes later, and I was inspecting the contents of a white plastic bag. A large bottle of Coke, lemonade, a dozen lethal Norwegian beers, and not one, but 2 10-glass bottles of vodka. With the last vestige of sense we could muster between us, we took the country route to Coldwater, stopping once to take a piss, clutching cans, making steaming trails of urine in the moonlit air of some farmer's gateway. The conversation became an extension of what I'd started in the Heart Bar. You can do anything you want. Anybody can. But you gotta decide what's right. You gotta choose your responsibilities and live within the limitations that your choice dictates. Right, dead on. Whatever it is, your wife or your family or your job or whatever, only you can figure out what's right and what's wrong. I guess I was boring in my drunken profundity, but the message was obviously getting through, for Paddy stopped grinning for a moment, and the only sound was that of the car rattling and roaring down treacherous country roads. Dicky-doo! He cackled. What? I replied, thinking he was calling me for talking shit. You're right, dicky-doo! What the fuck is dicky-doo, I had to ask. He took a slug of his beer, took a stiff bend at 45 with one hand on the wheel, rammed the can back between his thighs and began to howl, Dicky-doo! 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 And I started howling too. Dicky-doo! We howled, over and over again at the tops of our voices, eventually laughing insanely, two mad dogs getting kicks off each other's faces. This is the place to be! We screamed. We opened the windows to the blasting air, threw our empty cans into the dark, and cracked open two more. Calmer, I asked, are you going to tell me what dicky-doo is? Right. I'm on guard outside the boiler room at Market Hill, right? Right. Market Hill is in Enniskillen, border country where they send rookie policemen to train, do border patrol, get blown up on occasion, become real men. There's a super sare heater in the boiler room, right? A gas heater, you know? Yeah. It's wild cold down there, even with your greatcoat on and your flak jacket and all underneath it. So you go in now and then to the super stair to get warm. It's the place to be, eh? Eh? Yeah. Well, I was in there one night and this bird came in. Don't know who she was, right? He gave me a silly grin and I said, Right. You know you were saying that you do what's right in your circumstances. Yeah. This bird, she was wearing a fur coat and she asked me if it was cool. So I said, aye, you know. Well, I knew what he was talking about, but the pieces of the conversation weren't coming together as far as I was capable of judging. I was slugging beer and he was grinning lecherously. You're losing me, Paddy, I said. Great, she was asking for it, see? And it's the most natural thing to do, isn't it? Yeah. I thought at this point that I was wrong to try to hang on to themes and threads with this guy. I fucked her on top of the superstar. What else could I do, eh? Eh? And that's dicky-doo? Aye, like you said, you can only do the right thing in the circumstances. And if you're honest about it, your dicky-doo what your dicky has to do, eh? Dicky-doo! Dicky-doo! That's the place to be, Davy. That's the place to be. You're dicky in a country. That's the place to be. Until we got to the car park at Coldwater House, I screamed, Dicky-doo! As long and as loud as Paddy. We drank our beer and laughed like maniacs.
She should ask Matt, she says, old dad. So I'm going to print all the stuff up at the old shed.
The Waterhouse is owned by an uncle of Paddy's wife, a fact that ensured us tenure long past normal hours should we so desire it. It also meant that Paddy's cheque was good, and I would say the evening had cost him over £50 thus far, me not a penny. I had no money to start with, and I made it clear I wouldn't even owe him. He was leading me anyway, removing even guilt from my mind. A clean toilet with lovely mirrors revealing our ruddy faces and bleary eyes. More vodka at the bar. The barmaid was a fish-eyed creature of about 30 years, name of May. Closing time came and went. The customers thinned out to a few clumps of locals. The lights went down. Shutters surrounded the bar. Paddy and I wandered outside. Around the back of the hotel, lights and people attracted our attention. In the main function room, something seemed to be happening. A party, perhaps. Some private function. Sure enough, we found ourselves in the middle of a wedding party. Whose, we never found out. But the bar was open and we talked about the girls there. This time only whispering, "Tiki doo." Wedding parties are peopled by young men, young women, older men and older women. They are occasions with a purpose, and not the kind of place to go searching for companionship. I have an instinct that tells me if a course of action is likely or not to endanger my health, and I have this feeling here. I'm sure that if Paddy had persuaded me to follow his dicky-doo instinct, we would have ended up the victims of some enraged, protective gang of relatives, beaten to a pulp for plain stupidity. I steered us outside. There, we swilled vodka around our glasses, discussed the traps of society and the inherent pain of existence. Under hanging trees and a full moon, our plan to go to Dublin was evolved. I put my empty glass in my pocket before we went back to the hotel for another drink. Of course, we never made Dublin. We used, "Are you going to Dublin?" as a catchphrase the rest of the night. We did stay a long time after ours at Coldwater House, talking gibberish with May and a humorless bouncer who hovered as if on a mission. May wasn't going to Dublin any more than we were, but she served us vodka and green chartreuse again and again, for the road, for the road. By 5 a.m., we had roared to Ballymena, woken an off-duty police friend of Paddy's, retreated after my pouring drinks on the lawn met with whispered protestation, checked out the septic tank at Paddy's building site. That big, pale egg sat beside the hole that was to have been buried in the previous night. Paddy sober. I disliked him. Or rather, my dislike of him surfaced as he faced his intoxication. I was every bit as drunk as he was, every bit as stupid, yet I was aware of it. He was tired and remembering. My petrol was running low. There was petrol in his car parked at Dark Hooks. We were going to Dublin. We switched cars. Paddy wasn't playing anymore in his brand new Astra, white and shining. Okay in my old Escort, rusty doors, dirty windows, okay to be irresponsible, but here we were in his expensive pride and joy, and he never wanted to go to Dublin anyway. Neither did I particularly, but I was going. Slam door. "Fuck you, Paddy." I went inside and crashed on the sofa.
Jimmy cleared off with his bloody brother's wife.
He does,
right?
Oh, aye, aye.
Is that right? Everybody that called Jumpy worked on it.
Jumpy?
Jumpy something to call him. His dad was a plumber. His dad went to live in Ballyclare or something. Jumpy, the cop that he fell a nickname.
Living in Ballyclare.
Oh, No, he left Bally Crime up with us. He was a plumber or someone.
Anybody you want to know anything about?
She'll tell you.
I think I was a gossip to hear you. You know, Valerie was up in Ballyclare a fortnight ago. She was standing on websites in Ballyclare. And this man came over to tell her. And he spoke to her. And he says, I think I know you. And Valerie says, well, I don't know you. Who are you? And he says, I'm Irvin. Live down in Red Hall. Uh-huh. And they must call the wife for every ill, the dirty bitches and everything. She wouldn't dare help that wee woman. You really buy her a pram in case she would boot. Mm-hmm. You know, she's a nice wee woman. Mm-hmm. And she had 10 of a family.
Mm. Is that...
Trevor's father.
Well, he was a bad bugger.
Aye, well, he's left this the woman he went away with. He's left her too.
Oh.
And he's...
Is he still living?
Take courage in a world full of people. You can lose sight of it all in the darkness. Who inside you make you feel so small? And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors are beautiful like a rainbow. Show me a smile then. Don't be unhappy, can't remember when I last saw you laughing. If this world makes you crazy and you've taken all you can bear, you call me up because you know I'll be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors are beautiful like a rainbow. This world makes you crazy, you've taken all you can bear. You call me up because you know I'll be there. And I see your true colors shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors. True colors are shining through. I see your true colors, and that's why I love you. So don't be afraid to let them show your true colors. True colors are beautiful like a rainbow.
just been on to director inquiries.
Yes.
Does it cost me money to talk to you now?
No, it's not costing you any money, sir.
That's okay. Right. I've been trying to ring a number in San Antonio and...
Is that in Texas?
It's in Texas, yes.
Yes.
I've been dialing 0101512, and then the number which I have is 2713294.
Yes.
I'm getting something that sounds almost like a dialing tone, but not quite.
Are you sure that's not the ringing tone in the States, sir?
I don't know.
The ringing tone in America is a bit like the continent. It's unlike our ringing tone.
Is it longer
it's
than...
It's a little a ring and a pause. Give me it, I'll try it myself separately. You're not charged here. Yeah. What's the number? 51, area 512.
Yes, 271-3294.
271-3294. Hold the line and let me try it myself separately. Hold on.
Thank you.
Hello, sir.
Yeah.
That's the American ringing tone you're getting, sir.
Is it?
That's the ringer. Can the button be no reply?
There's no reply.
Okay.
Okay, that's fine.
Thank you, sir. Bye.
I'm the one who's 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 the one who
see the kids.